Hi everyone, I'm Sylvain Baillet and I'm here today with François Tadel to introduce you to Brainstorm, the software application we've been developing over the years to do electrophysiology and electromagnetic brain mapping in a MATLAB environment. We are both from the McConnell Brain Imaging Center here at the Montreal Neurological Institute, McGill University. So the objectives for today's webinar is basically to introduce you to the software environment and application, which we consider being a versatile application for, like I said, electrophysiology and brain imaging. So we're gonna focus essentially on three items today. We're gonna demonstrate how we can process and visualize very efficiently electrophysiological data in a user-friendly environment. Very importantly for research studies where you have, you know, several conditions, several subjects, potentially different kinds of data, we will show you how Brainstorm can organize, help you organize and explore this vast amount of data. And finally, we're going to demonstrate how we can easily build and share pipelines of data analysis using scripting tools within Brainstorm, so that you can basically promote open science and also promote reproducibility of your research. So first of all, we thought it would be interesting to go through basically the basic principles of MEG and EEG with an emphasis on their capacity to do imaging. So in the brain, as you know, we have billions and billions of neurons and these guys exchange electrical signals. And every time you have an electrical current flowing in a medium, there is an electromagnetic wave that is created. So here on the left, it's a coronal view of a brain, and the little red arrow is an elementary current flow that is of neural origins. So every time there is a current, like I said, there is an electromagnetic field that is generated, and this is visualized here with the orange for electric currents and the green lines for the magnetic field. And imagine you have the proper sensors outside the head, then you can basically capture the time evolution of this electromagnetic field with no delay. So in that respect, MEG and EEG and electrophysiology in general are really the best tools to do time-resolved brain imaging and brain exploration of the brain activity. So you can go further than that. Imagine you have hundreds and hundreds of sensors around the head, as in today's modern MEG and EEG instruments, then you can really have, you end up having an array of signals, multi-dimensional signals that you need to process. So if you want to do imaging, you need to have a better understanding, a good understanding of the physics. And basically we solve Maxwell equations with quasi-static assumptions using a forward modeling approach, as in many other fields of research. And also, as in many other fields of research, we do inverse reconstruction, inverse modeling, if you will, which basically then generate images like this, where the orange blobs represent an estimation of the electrical activity of the brain. But you have to imagine it's one image like this every millisecond or even less, meaning that the temporal resolution and the volume of data is really outstanding. Actually, what can you do with this? You can do mapping of brain functions, so localize the areas responsible for language, memory, vision, etc. And most importantly, given the millisecond time resolution, you can really explore new models and new mechanisms of possible collaboration in the brain, between the brain regions, between the language and memory regions, for instance. And this is a new field that is really, really a hot topic these days in neuroscience, the field of brain network connectivity. So just a few words on MEG and EEG data collection. I guess most of you know already very well, at least the principles of EEG. It's a relatively cheap, at least very cost-effective way of measuring brain waves. So you can do that in the clinic. You can do that in a lab with many, many sensors approaching 300. But also, what we see these days is a renaissance of brain-computer interface using dry electrode technology, which is also very cheap, relatively cheap, I should say, and very cost-effective. MEG is definitely another beast because you use hundreds of sensors that are superconducting, measuring femtotesla magnetic fields. So it's really a research tool, but also a clinical tool in the US and other countries. So contributors to the project. So it's, as you can see, over the years, there's been many, many different contributors, essentially from McGill, USC, the Cleveland Clinic. The three main principal investigators are Richard Leahy at USC, John Mosier at the Cleveland Clinic, and myself here at the MNI at McGill. This is François, who is basically the head of the software development in the team. And the funding over the years has been provided by many different sources, but most importantly and more recently by a dedicated R01 grant from the NIH. So we have a very strong user community over the years, and actually it's really ramping up over the past couple of years. And as you can see, this is a map, a world map, where every dot basically represents a focus of users. So it's pretty much everywhere. And the little brains on top of it represent the training sessions we've been doing a bit more aggressively. I mean that in a good way. Over the past 2-3 years. And if we look at the numbers, we've probably trained approaching 1,000 users on every continent, more or less. So our data today, when we're going to go through the demonstration, is an auditory oddball task, which consists in the presentation of standard tones presented in both ears. And every once in a while, there will be a deviant tone, as we say, which is relatively rare. But it's easy to detect behaviorally, if you will. And every time the subject is going to hear a deviant tone, then he or she will have to press a button with the right index finger. So it's a relatively standard or relatively classic paradigm. The goal again today is not so much to do groundbreaking neuroscience in this webinar, but more to feature the tools in Brainstorm. We're going to look at 6 minutes of recording, and now it's time for a demo. All right, so we're going to start MATLAB here to get started with the demonstration. Just to let you know, we have on our website all the, the compiled version of the software in case users are interested to use it without a MATLAB license. So we're going to run Brainstorm here. And essentially, it's going to be the last command line interaction you're going to do, because the rest of the story is basically focused on using graphical user interface. So here, this is the main Brainstorm window, where on the left you have the panel where the database explorer and data tree will be populated a bit later on. To the right, you have contextual and dedicated panels. It's going to become a bit more clear as we go through the demonstration. And at the bottom, it's basically a data bucket, as we call it, where you can drag and drop elements from the database to run basically batch analysis. So we're going to import, create a new protocol first. So basically, a new protocol is a new experiment. It's a set of data consisting usually of several subjects, several participants. We're going to call it webinar. And now we're going to create a new subject, a new participant to the study. Let's call it subject one by default. And as you've seen very briefly in the slides, we need to import the anatomy of the subject using MRI. So the good thing with Brainstorm is that we have the capacity to import basically anatomy files from a wide range of data formats, be it relatively raw MRI files to basically process files with the most common MRI processing applications on the market. So here it's a FreeSurfer processed MRI volume and the surfaces you will see later. This is the MRI viewer that is fully integrated in three dimensions, if I may say so. So you have the three typical panels, orthogonal panels, and planes of MR visualization. And now we are navigating through the volume, and we're going to mark three essential points nasion, right and left auditory or periauricular points, because these three points basically are necessary to register MEG and EEG recordings that we will see later on with the anatomy. And again, the purpose of that is really to have the most accurate estimation of brain activity from this surface recording. So MRI is relatively essential here. We're going to mark also typical anatomical landmarks that are used eventually to register and co-register subjects with one another to conduct group studies. Once this is done, BrainStorm basically will import the whole packet of MRI files and processed MRI files, so the volume, but also the surfaces that you will see in a moment. We have also the capacity to import atlases and regions of interest that have been identified by some of these MRI processing software. So you will see a demonstration of that in a moment, including subcortical atlases with basically the thalamus and the putamen, all these very important subcortical regions. Okay, so now this is done, and you see that BrainStorm is displaying the 3D rendering of the scalp surface and also, most importantly, the cortical surface. And so we're going to display now, if you look at the cortex a bit more in detail. And one of the good things is that we benefit from, you know, interacting, as you can see here with the sliders, interacting visualization using transparency, smoothing of the surface to reveal what's inside the folds. And as you can see, this is definitely a patch, you know, surface. You've seen the nodes, you can manipulate and visualize very efficiently. Now we can also call and load in directly the some of the regions of interest that have been identified automatically by the previous MRI software, and you see that all the information is here, and it's going to be very clear why it's important a bit later. And if you want to just clean up your desktop, then you just press that crosshair. It empties the memory, cleans up the environment, and you can continue with your work. All right, so now we're going to switch to the functional aspects of the data. So you see this button, and it's going to change the display of the database. Here you see all the anatomy-related files, and now if I click that button here in the middle, I need to populate basically and import some data from electrophysiology. So today we're going to look at this MEG audio file. First we're going to review and QC the data. It's important to see that today we're working with a MEG MEG CTF format data file, but as you can see from this pull-down menu, we can work with BrainStorm with a large selection of EEG and MEG files. So if you guys are working with a specific data format that we don't feature in the software, please let us know through the forum and we'd be happy to add it. Now this is a rendering of basically the helmet, and I'm going to just adjust a little bit the position of the head in the helmet to make sure the registration is close to perfect with MRI. And so the yellow surface you see here is basically a rendering of the inner surface of the MEG helmet, where the sensors are located. And the green points are basically scalp points that we have digitized at the moment of data collection. So they help improve the registration. So let's clean that up and let's go directly to the data. right-click, and right-clicking is very, very useful and very powerful in Brainstorm. Brings up a lot of contextual menus like this one. We can display the time series of the different, you know, you can display the time series of EEG, cardio, etc. Today we're going to look at MEG essentially. So this is a view where basically you have a sub-selection of the sensors. It's a typical page that electrophysiologists you know, use a lot. So time series, each row is a sensor. You can look at all channels at once, but you know, good luck with that. We have close to 300 sensors here over minutes of recording. Here we display only 3 seconds, about 3 seconds. You can decide to use a butterfly view of the different time series. But I think the most efficient is to go back to sub-selection, like here, left temporal sensors. So you can navigate with the cursor or using these different buttons. So for instance, if I decide to go basically sample by sample, we're going to take you know, 1 micro or millisecond at a time and navigate in the data. You can also use jumps of several seconds, like this. Or you can decide to basically change the page. So it's like turning the page of a book. Every page is 3 seconds. You can adjust the duration of your display from here 3 seconds to exactly 3 seconds, or maybe a bit longer, typical 10 seconds pages. Here we see an eye artifact. Okay, so you can see also that by clicking, I can navigate in the page. I see also, we can also select basically data chunks, and we can decide whether they are good or bad. But also I can navigate very efficiently through the whole file. Remember, it's a 6-minute file, so I can click everywhere I want at the bottom of the screen, like I'm showing now. Maybe I'm going to reduce the size of the window, and maybe I can click further down into the file using the little cursor here. You see, I can jump readily into the file and review, like we just saw in a moment ago, some artifacts like we see here. I can use also keyboard shortcut, so you guys cannot see, but I can very efficiently navigate, not using the mouse, but using actually keyboard shortcuts. Same story here. And there are contextual tooltips that you have under every button, basically. So not only does it explain to you what it does, but there is also, you know, the shortcuts that are documented there. Okay, now a very important aspect of research, but also the clinical work in electrophysiology, are events of interest. You know, this is gigabytes of data, but we may be interested only in specific events where a tone was presented to the subject. Like here for standard, or when a deviant tone was shown. So look at this feature. The events of interest are imported directly into Brainstorm. So you have the 3 categories, including the button press. And to the right, every time you select a category, you have the actual latency of when this event of interest happened in the file. And I can click on either of these latencies, and the display will be automatically and very rapidly updated. Now, of course, very importantly, you need to be able to adjust the gain of your display. You can use the mouse wheel or use the buttons, but there are also some shortcuts, keyboard shortcuts. So, as you can already appreciate, I guess, a great deal of user interaction and interactivity with the graphical user interface. Okay, so now we're gonna continue our quality control of the file, and I'm gonna take this opportunity to feature the process tab operations. So let me drag and drop my raw file here. I could process just this one, but many others if I had more today. So, and I'm going to work on the recording and press run button to select from a library of processes. And today, what I'm going to do for now is compute a power spectrum. Let's go. So there are a few parameters that I can adjust, basically, for a typical power spectrum. We're going to limit this on the first 100 seconds. The window length will be adjusted to 2 seconds. And Here you go. So as you can see, it creates a new object in the database. It's the power spectrum in question. And this is typical of electrophysiological recordings. So you have a 1 over f decrease. You have the frequencies on the x-axis and the power on the left axis. And I'm taking also this opportunity to show you the interaction between multiple visualization windows. So on your left is basically the topography of the data, which is basically a way to realize how the power of the data is distributed in space. So I see the sensors, and now I can navigate in the spectrum from the very low to the very high. You see that the very low is typical of high blink artifacts that are common in electrophysiology. As I use the keyboard to move up in the spectrum, I can see different patterns, like here around 10 Hertz is a typical alpha wave that is very prominent in most subjects. As I move up and getting closer and closer to 60 Hertz. This is a pattern that is a bit noisy for the good reason that it's essentially the power line contamination. And the rest is essentially could be contamination from the neck muscles, as you can see here, possibly over 50 to 80 Hertz. And another harmonic of the power line. So what I want to feature here is basically the fact that I can interact with the data both in the time and frequency domain, and basically also visualize in space where basically contamination or signal is the most prominent in the different frequency bands. So now we're going to go a bit further and basically remove or attenuate some of these contaminations. And we're going to use a notch filter to remove power line contamination. So I'm select notch filter from the library, and I can select the frequencies I want to remove. So here in Canada, this is 60 Hertz, the main, and a couple of harmonics. The notch filter is applied on all the channels available in the file. It creates a new element in the database. You see, it adds automatically a description of the process that has been applied on the data. And I will basically recompute the power spectrum to appreciate the performance of the notch filter. This is my new power spectrum for the corrected data, and you see that the notch has been properly applied at the target frequencies. So this is, and I can compare by bringing up the previous spectrum and appreciating at least visually the efficacy of the processing. And again, this is an important feature. As you can see, you can bring up several windows from different data sets in the same on the same desktop, and all the views are actually synchronized in, like I said before, multiple dimensions, here frequencies. So there is more to QC. Actually, in electrophysiology, there are many different artifacts like we saw before. Here we're gonna show the ability or capacity to remove and first detect and then remove artifacts from cardiac and also eye blinks. So as you see here, we have simultaneous recording of EOG for eye movements and cardiac ECG. So, by the way, we can reorganize the display in a more principled manner to weight, you know, windows and give more real estate to windows where there are more channels, as you can see here. So you can navigate through the different pages again. And here I'm going to show, an event like at the peak of this cardiac heartbeat. You can see some contamination in the MEG traces. And one here, and there's going to be another one here at the vertical line. And a few seconds later, you see this huge artifact, which is due to an eye movement. as you can see from the electrooculogram recording. So what we're going to do is detect those events automatically. You can detect them by hand, but actually when they are quite stereotypical like these two guys, you can use the tools in Brainstorm to basically detect them automatically. So we're going to select the ECG channel. You see that it creates a new event category, cardiac, and I can jump from one event to the next and click from the list, and I can verify actually whether this is indeed a cardiac event or not. So this is looking good. I'm going to do the same with the eye blinks. I select the channel that contains the EOG information, where the actual recording of eye movements and blinks is best. Another category, and I can jump from one event to the next. So this is very efficient, very fast, and once I have that, then we can remove basically or attenuate contamination from these two categories of artifacts. So for that, there are many ways of doing it. What we prefer is to basically use a form of principal component analysis that basically look into the various aspects of the signals in time windows about each event and remove basically the principal contaminant from these time windows. So this is done here. And after that, we're going to select basically components that we think are responsible for contamination. So you can basically select from the list of components, appreciate whether the topography is compatible with heartbeats. And as you can see, every time I click and select or deselect a component, it actually applies the correction on the fly. So you can really appreciate whether the heartbeat has been properly removed or attenuated from the MEG. That's the case here. We're going to do the same with eye movements. It might be a bit more dramatic. So this is now applied, but if I unselect, you see very, very clearly in that page how efficient the removal has been. So now that this is done, we're going to now import the segments of interest in our data, which are basically surrounding the presentation of the tones, as you remember. So we're going to import in the database the segments of data. And by the way, all the projectors and correction factors that we have designed previously are automatically applied on the fly. So I'm selecting two events of interest here, standard and deviant. I define the epoch time 100 milliseconds before the presentation of the tone, 500 milliseconds after. It's importing now in the database all these 240 different events. So you see it's creating now a new folder, and all the data is now properly organized. And if I'm interested in the deviant responses or responses to standards, then I can really go and basically fetch the trial number one, benefit from the viewing options I've briefly described before. And this is a butterfly view of all the sensors overlaid. So I can play with the scale, travel in time. And if I press F3, I navigate through the database trial by trial. It's very efficient, actually, to decide whether a trial is good or bad, depending on artifacts. I can navigate with the menus as well. I can decide to reject this trial because there's been a movement or some contamination from outside. I can select a given channel, etc. So there's not much we can do to illustrate basically the software with just one trial, if you will. So we're going to average multiple trials from the same category together. So here I select 40 responses to deviant tones, 40 responses to standard tones, so that we have the same number of events. You see that it's all well documented and featured in the process tab. Same logic, I'm going to select from the library what I need, average files. Many different ways of doing it, but we're going to do it by condition. It generates two new files, signaled as average. So let's have a look at this. So now you can see that from the baseline before the simulation, marked with a dashed line, you see deviation, you see an augmentation of amplitude from the brain responses. It's typical from event-related averages. So maybe it's a bit noisy. We're going to apply a filter on the fly. So you see that we can apply a high-pass filter, low-pass filter to at 40 Hz. And now you can see much more clearly, even though we are looking at 300 traces from the butterfly plot, you can see the response. So now we can integrate space into the visualization, like we've seen before. And so this latency here is around 100 milliseconds. Actually, if I move to 50 milliseconds here, also we start to see, you know, basic typical topography of responses from the auditory cortex, like this blue and red here are typical from a stronger response from the left auditory cortex. There are many different ways of visualizing. I'm going to look at the EEG, by the way. We have recorded a couple of EEG channels for this experiment, and you see also the responses. Again, the feature here today is to basically give you a taste for, you know, the integration of the different modalities in the same environment and the synchronization in the visualization. Yeah, there are many different ways of looking at the data. So here it's for each sensor, there is the event-related trace that is featured, and I can select one, two, three, several channels with the mouse, and it's going to highlight basically where these sensors are on this topography. And as you can see above, if I select one specific sensor here, it's going to highlight the time series in red over there. So this is one condition, but I can bring up the same kind of visualization for the other condition, the deviant responses to deviant tones. And I can basically reproduce the same kind of display so that I can really appreciate, again, purely visually today, for now, the differences between the two conditions. I can blow that up a little bit. And you can see that the early response is pretty much the same in the two conditions. And it's slightly later that the brain realizes that, oh, it's a deviant tone, and there's going to be an increase in amplitude known as the mismatch negativity, which is quite typical of the brain detecting a rare event from a series of standards. So these event-related responses are basically the signals of interest we're going to use for now source imaging. So this is the imaging part. For that, as you've seen from the slides, we need to compute a head model, which is the forward model. And there are many different ways of doing it with, you know, even realistic boundary element methods. The file is created here, it's part of the database. We also need to have an estimation of the noise statistics. So this is another feature we're going to compute from the files. We're going to select basically the pre-stimulus baseline as basically a signature of signal of no interest, so what we would qualify as noise. This is the noise covariance matrix here. And the last thing is to compute an imaging kernel, which will be applied to the data. So this is the inverse modeling part. And as you can see, it creates a file in the database. And it's actually linked to each and every data file, including single trials. So you can basically have a very efficient way to compute or estimate sources for all your data available. Okay, let's bring up the result and imaging portion of the analysis. So now we are starting 100 milliseconds before the presentation of the steam, so essentially it's noise. And you can travel again, like we said before, in time. And as you can see, around 100 milliseconds after stimulation, there is the typical response of the auditory cortex right here, shown in red. You can, for visualization, change the threshold. Here, we're going to set it as a 60% of the dynamic range of the data. Okay, let's travel a little bit in time. So early response from the auditory cortex, then very rapidly afterwards detection that this is indeed a deviant tone, around 145 milliseconds in the most anterior portion of the brain. So basically the work is done by the brain, and eventually there's going to be the preparation and execution of the response from the right finger, so which is all managed by the left somatosensory and sensory motor cortex, as you can see here in red. So again, dynamic representation of complex data in 3D and 2D. So let's review a bit more in details the responses from specific brain regions. So let's bring up the 3D viewer of the source time series. We've seen that around 100 milliseconds there is this early response from the auditory cortex, and we're going to define a region of interest that we call scout in Brainstorm. So I'm going to use that crosshair, grow a region around this red dot here, adjust a little bit to the right size. I can rename using a typical nomenclature, so like A1 for auditory, primary auditory cortex. And what I can do is press this little oscilloscope button, and it's going to bring up basically the time series of the very local activity estimated from the MEG traces. And same story, I can navigate in time by using the cursor or my mouse. And basically you're going to see in green here the time series from that region. So we can add a few more. So again, this is the processing of the deviant tone. We have a response from the inferior frontal cortex, the inferior frontal gyrus. Let's do it by hand and grow a little region around this area of interest. I'm going to rename it as inferior frontal gyrus. And maybe one last one around the motor response here that is very, very clear over the precentral region. Let's call it M1 as motor, primary motor region. And basically I can select all these three regions and press the oscilloscope button. And now I can review each time series separately, or I can decide to overlay all three together so that I can better appreciate basically the chronometry that is taking place. So if we go around 50 milliseconds, there is the very, very early onset of the auditory response. And then later by 150, there is this typical response of the deviant to the deviant tones, and then some complex processing occurring there. But just for the sake of demonstration today, you see that later it's very clear that the blue trace, which is from the motor region, is actually taking over and it becomes very, very, very strong. And it corresponds to the button press. So let's explore a bit further the fine-grained relation or registration of function with anatomy. And we're going to bring up the MRI volume as we've seen briefly before. So we're going to look at the most prominent response from the auditory cortex here. As you can see, I select and navigate in the volume using the cursor, and I can apply exactly the same thresholds as with the 3D view. So it's a bit patchy here, so we're going to smooth out the functional map using 3D smoothing, as typical in functional imaging. And so I can zoom in and explore. Actually, we see very, very nicely here Eschol's gyrus, which is one of the key structure in anatomy related to the auditory cortex. So it's very nice to see this alignment. Now, to better appreciate what's happening in the volume, We can use maximum intensity projection and basically have adopt a glass brain view, as is typical also in brain imaging. And you see that now the patterns and the blobs, functional blobs, are fixed, and it's actually very efficient if I want to produce basically illustrations for articles and papers or presentations. So talking about snapshots, we can actually generate those directly into Brainstorm, and you see that right click and snapshot, and I can save what I see as an image, but I can also save the entire volume using different views. I can bring up the same regions of interest as the ones we've seen in 3D, and to better appreciate where they are located in the MRI. So we're going to continue a bit further on analysis of these time series in the cortex by computing a time frequency decomposition of the brain rhythms. For that, I'm going to bring up the 40 responses to deviant trials. I'm going to work on the brain time series, not the sensor time series. You see that it's basically looking at each and every single cortical response to every trial. I'm going to select the time frequency tool I want from the library. So frequency domain, we can do Hilbert transforms, but today I'm going to work on Morlet wavelets. The scouts I've defined before are here, ready to be processed. I could select to basically process the entire cortical time series, but I'm going to restrict the analysis today on these three regions of interest with the following parameters. So I'm going to look at a frequency range from 150 hertz in 40 steps of logarithmic bins in the spectrum. And at the end of the day, I can decide to compute each and every individual time frequency map and save it to the file, to an individual file. But here I'm going to save only their average for the sake of demonstration. Here you go. So you see that it creates a new object in my database, which is a time frequency map. But maybe you remember from the spectrum we show that there is a 1/f decrease of the power in brain signal. So to boost higher frequencies, we see a very nice low frequency response here. But to reveal high frequency power changes, we're going to apply a simple z-score of the time frequency map with respect to its own baseline. So this is done also readily using the toolbar. By the way, I could have selected the z-score pipeline right together with the time frequency decomposition. So we select a 100 millisecond baseline as a reference for the power, and it creates this new standardized time frequency map. And this is the visualization. So the x-axis is time, and the y-axis is frequency, and the colors represent basically modulations or variations of power in the different frequency band at each time instant. I can select to smooth the display a little bit, select the region of interest that I want to look at. We're going to look at the primary auditory cortex, and we can play interactively, like in every other actually Brainstorm figure, with the color bar to play with the contrast or the brightness. Or maybe I want to use a jet color bar, and this is extremely color map, sorry, and this is extremely simple here. So for the neuroscience geeks in the room, you can very easily see, you know, increase of power in the low alpha theta range, and also a very nice and narrow band augmentation of power in response to the deviant tone around the low gamma 40 hertz band. If I'm happy with this figure, I can decide to save it as a snapshot. Right click, save as image, or even save as a MATLAB figure. So far we've been doing a lot of button clicks, interacting a lot with the graphical user interface, but actually for productivity and reproducibility and sharing basically your analysis pipeline, everything can be done using the pipeline builder. So let's go back to the raw file, and what we're going to do is build a pipeline to basically import the data and average it with a script. So let's see how we can do that. We drag and drop the raw file, select from the library the tools that we need. So first of all, we're going to import the recordings, and we're going to import some events of interest. So let me type in the two events of interest, standard and deviant tones. The epoch time is basically the one that we had selected before. So that's the first element of the pipeline. Then I can decide to remove the DC offset, for instance, as an elementary process. I can also basically decide to average my files according to the category of the condition, and so on and so forth. I can compute the head model, I can do source activation or source estimation, compute the noise covariance. So if you look at the top of this window, there is actually the graphical representation of the pipeline itself. And then I can review each and every element, decide to reorder either element from the top to the bottom, and or decide that an element is not necessary after all. Here we're going to just restrict our analysis and our pipeline to a relatively simple one that comprises three steps. Then that could become your elementary pipeline for your own library. So you can decide to save it to your local, basically, installation of Brainstorm. So I'm going to enter a name for this pipeline, for instance, webinar. And as you can see, I can load it readily from the interface here tomorrow, or I can decide to basically share it with a friend by either saving it as a MAT file or generating a M script, a MATLAB script. So let me feature this aspect here. And as you can see, it brings up the MATLAB editor with a very nicely and very well organized MATLAB scripts, where here I see my input files, which is basically my data file. And then with comments in between, I can readily identify the different processes, as we call them, the different elements of processing with the input and output parameters that basically go in succession and sequentially in the script. So it's very important to mention that it's great for you, it's great for your collaborators in terms of sharing and reproducibility, but you can also, in between two different processes, contribute your own and basically have your own script or tool that you want to use in the middle of the more standard ones from Brainstorm. Another thing important to mention is that all these elementary processes you've seen in the library, they are written as standardized plugins, which is important because it means that you can contribute your own and basically share with the Brainstorm community, and it's relatively easy to basically feature your contribution as part of this toolkit and through the user interface and the graphical user interface here. So we welcome every good-willing contributions for code sharing as a plugin to Brainstorms. As advertised in our introduction slide, Brainstorm is also a tool to do basically clinical electrophysiology and basic electrophysiology. So let's switch to another protocol from Epilepsy Data, where we do have access to electrocorticographic recordings. So let's have a look at the channels and how they are displayed and positioned on the cortex. It's actually a set of strips and cortical grids, as you see with the yellow discs here. Each yellow object is basically an electrode sitting on top of the cortex. I can bring up this, the scalp and basically select and interact with the channel just as before. So now let's bring up some data. And so we have here an average interictal spike, which is a manifestation of epilepsy. And now we can, as before also, interact in the time domain and the 3D basically anatomy to visualize the data. So the blue and red colors basically represent the variations of electrical potential picked up at the surface of the cortex about the interictal spike. So as you can see, the spike is a very sharp event in time, which is basically a few tens of milliseconds wide. So we can summarize basically the excursion of the dynamics by generating either a movie or a contact sheet directly from the contextual menu. So let's do it in 12 different steps around the spike activity. And Brainstorm will generate automatically for you basically these snapshots that are subsequently very convenient basically to first appreciate the dynamics of the brain, but also, as you can imagine, very convenient for presentations and publications. So maybe one last thing we would like to feature today is also another form of electrophysiological exploration in clinical electrophysiology, and this is stereo EEG recordings, where basically electrodes are implanted in a patient participants for pre-surgical evaluation. So here we are bringing up basically the 3D viewer of the MRI. It's yet another visualization tool of Brainstorm's. And you see it's again very highly interacting. You can basically select the slice you prefer in the three orthogonal views of the MRI. So we can play with the transparency so that you can see basically the different aspects of the volume. And importantly, what you can appreciate here is the localization of the depth electrodes that have been implanted. And in that respect, it's very much akin to what one does in animal electrophysiology as well. And as before, there is a great deal of interaction between the time series of the data at the top, where you can see yet another epileptic spike, and the 3D rendering at the bottom, where the colors again represent the intensity of the activity locally around the electrode. So that's pretty much it for the demo of the software today. I hope you very much enjoyed it. I'd like to review with you guys the objectives that we had set for today's session. So we introduced Brainstorm, and I hope you appreciated the diversity of the tools and also the fact that it can be used for EEG and electromagnetic brain imaging, but also more basic and clinical electrophysiology. And it's easy to build, you know, advanced processing pipelines and visualization or benefit from visualization routines in 2D, 3D, and multiple other dimensions with this user-friendly environment. And we've seen that with the Database Explorer, you can really organize and explore your data in, like I said before, multiple dimensions. And also, very importantly, because neuroscience is eminently multidisciplinary, it's important to have the ability to share basically your analysis pipelines and even your data. And this is something you can do very easily with Brainstorm, as you've seen. And we've illustrated very briefly the scripting tool, but there are other features in the software to help you do that. So there are more resources online. I hope you feel like giving a try to the software and joining the community. There is a great deal of online tutorials where you can basically download data and follow step by step basically a training program that will bring you up to speed with the software. Like we said before, it's we benefit from a very strong user support and community, and we have a user forum to basically help you address possible bugs in the software, but also whenever you have questions regarding how you could analyze your own data, we are always here to help. And the download rate is actually accelerating, which is very good. It looks like the software has some substantial impact on the community. We also have a Facebook page, so please feel free to join us. And these are the links you can basically go to. And I would like to feature basically some aspects of the website. And this is it. Maybe importantly, I can click here on tutorials and you can appreciate basically the different aspects you see in 12 easy steps, as we say. You can really go through most of the things we've seen today and much more, including statistics and group analysis in some aspects of advanced tutorials. The user forum is also, like I said, very active with actually close to 7,000 posts. And I think we do a pretty good job, especially François, at replying very quickly and very thoroughly to your questions. And this is the community that we try to foster using social networking with announcements of events like today's webinar using Facebook. But also, if you go back to the website, you click on community here, and you would like to basically see if there is someone in your area. Imagine you live in Boston, you type in Boston to connect with other users, and you can find basically users in your region with whom you can basically connect if you want to, or basically interact, or maybe put together a training workshop. So that's basically it for the demonstration. Now we would like to basically, we would be very happy to take questions and hopefully deliver meaningful answers to you guys. Thank you again.